Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews is really a treasure. For those that have been here the last several months, realize we have been in this journey for over 20 weeks, and we have literally studied this, tried to study it chapter by chapter. What you learn about Hebrews, it's a literary masterpiece. There are those who study Hebrews just because of the great literary work that it is. It's also a very practical letter. It has a lot of great wisdom. It has great instruction. It has great exhortation. It has great theology. It goes as deep as any other book in the Bible, and it gets as plain as the Proverbs in there. It tells you straight up what to do with what God has said in His Word. And I have enjoyed studying this book. I have enjoyed preaching through this book over the last several months. And I know I haven't even scratched the surface of all that there is into Hebrews. So I challenge you and encourage you to continue to study it. We have several more weeks that we're going to be studying through Hebrews. But I encourage you, if you have time in your quiet time, to read through it, to study through it. And the main purpose is why we called it Jesus is Greater. Because the purpose of studying Hebrews is realizing that Jesus is greater. He is greater than anything in this world. And Hebrews puts it forward in his nature, in theology, in practical living, that he is worthy to be pursued. Everything you have is worth surrendering to God and following after Jesus Christ. And if you have not found that true to be in your life, I hope you will. Because I could tell you more than anything else, this series has opened my eyes to realize that the things of this world and the things that we pursue are not worthy compared to Jesus Christ. In Him is the promises of God. And this morning, as we get to Hebrews 11, we are in our sixth message just in this chapter. It's the faith chapter, the chapter of the Hall of Fame of Faith. It has described faith. It has tried to define faith. It illustrates faith. It gives examples of faith. And we know faith is essential to our walk with God. Hebrews 11:6 tells us, but without faith, it is impossible to please him, for he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. So having faith in God or walking with God is not an option. It's not an elective course. It is something that's essential to your walk with God. Those who want to walk with God must walk by faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please him. And so you say, what is faith? Faith is trust. Faith is action. Faith is substance. Faith is evidence. Faith is seeing what is not visible, but knowing it exists. That's what faith is. What is not faith? Wishful thinking. A lot of people think, well, I just got faith. No, you have wishful thinking. A lot of people say, well, I got faith because I can get God to do whatever I want him to do. That's the will that I have. That's not faith. Faith is not getting God to do your will. Faith is not positive thinking. Faith is not everything in your life will be good at the moment. Do you only have faith in God knowing that he will give you something good for the moment? It doesn't work that way. Faith is trusting God with all that you have and leaving all the results to him. This is important because you got to get this. Because in life, when you come to faith, a lot of people think faith is just these good things that God does, and he does do great things. And we're going to learn about that day. We're going to pray, and we're going to see how God does great things in our life we can't do of our own power. But sometimes God chooses not to do those great things. Do you still have faith in God when he chooses not to do those great things? Because true biblical faith is trusting God and leaving all the results to him, every bit of it. And we've worked our way through many examples of this through the creation, through Abel, who brought the sacrifice of faith by faith, Enoch, who walked with God, and then God took him home, Noah, who built the ark, and he was saved in his household, Abraham, who was called out of the Ur of Chaldees, and he walked with God, or he obeyed God, Moses. Last week, we learned how the inheritance of faith from his parents, and how he grew up and refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, and he rejected the world to serve God. And there are so many more. And as we read this chapter 11, I'm going to read 10 verses to you. It's like a whirlwind. I mean, he literally begins to just throw all these examples at us. And he begins to throw this thing, and he closes this chapter out with a flurry. So I want to look at Hebrews 11, 30 through 40. All right, verses 30 through 40. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell down after they were encircled for 7 days. By faith, the harlot Rahab did not perish with those who did not believe, when she had received the promise, received the spies with peace. And what more shall I say? For the time would not fail me to tell of Gideon and Barak and Samson and Jephthah, also of David and Samuel and the prophets, who through faith subdued kingdoms, worked righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of lions, quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, out of weakness were made strong, became valiant in battle, turned to flight the armies of the aliens, women receiving their dead raised to life again. Others were tortured, not accepting deliverance, that they might obtain a better resurrection. Still others had trials of mockings and scourgings, yes, and of chains and imprisonment. They were stoned, they were sawn in two, were tempted, were slain with the sword. They wandered about in sheepskins and goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, tormented, of whom the world was not worthy. They wandered in deserts and mountains and dens and caves of the earth. And all these, having obtained a good testimony through faith, did not receive the promise. God having provided something better for us, that they should not be made perfect apart from us. For me, one of my favorite sports memories is captured on television was the 2008 National Championship game. For those of you who know who won the 2008 football championship game knows, I'm a Florida Gator fan, all right? And during that process, Tim Tebow was taking the Florida Gators, leading them up against the Oklahoma Sooners, who had the quarterback Sam Bradford, who won the Heisman Trophy, and they were averaging over 40 or 50 points a game, the offense. And so the game was a hard-fought game. They went into halftime, and during halftime it was 7-7, I believe, and Tebow was recorded in his locker room shouting to his guys, "Come on, guys. 30 minutes for the rest of our lives," all right? He's saying, let's suck it up and go out there and keep battling, and I can promise you, we're going to get the ball, I'm going to go down and score, and we're going to win the national championship, and we will be champions for the rest of our life. That's what he was literally saying. And unfortunately, that was the last game of any consequences they've won, all right? So it's been a long time. So got to live by faith and know that maybe one day they might come back. But he was exhorting them. That's what this writer is doing to us. He's exhorting us. Good plays, bad plays, everything that's happening, I'm exhorting you to take one more step. We know Hebrews was written to those who were considering turning back from the faith. And he was saying, wherever you are, take one more step. Go out there and play one more play. Go out there and battle one more time. Go out there and put one more foot in front of the other. Don't be discouraged. Don't turn back now. Keep walking. Keep walking by faith. And you do that when you trust in God and leave all the results to Him. You're putting everything you have in His hands. And when you do that, you do see some great and mighty things. You see God can do some great and mighty things. He begins with several great examples of this. Look at verse 30. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell down. After they were encircled by 7 days. You remember the story of Jericho. Jericho was the first city that Joshua was to conquer going into the promised land. As he went into the promised land, here was this walls, this city that had walls around it. And God told Joshua, "We're going to march in and conquer this city." The problem was the walls were so thick that they could race chariots around the top of them. And Joshua was like, "How in the world are we going to penetrate those walls? There's no way we could ever get inside to fight them or to defeat them." But God told Joshua, "You're going to conquer that city. And what you're going to do is, here's my plan. You're going to march around those walls for 6 days. And on the seventh day, you're going to walk around 6 times. And on the seventh time around, I want you to blow the trumpet." Sure, Joshua thought, "That's it? These walls are going to do what? And we're going to do what?" And they did it. And as you know the story, they get to the last one, they blow the trumpet. Sure enough, guess what happens? The walls came crumbling down. They blew the trumpet, and God tore the walls down. I mean, what a great miracle. I mean, I can just imagine being there, not by the power of Joshua, seeing the power of God. That man thought it was impossible, but God did the impossible in one moment. By the faith of Joshua and by the faith of Israelites, they took down and saw God do something that no one else could do. Look at verse 31. By faith, Rahab, who did not perish because those who did not believe when she had received the spies with peace. Same story. Joshua was going into the promised land. He needed to send spies to understand where he was going to go and come up with a game plan. So word got out. They heard about these spies. They wanted to kill them. And so Rahab went to the spies and said, I've heard of your God. I've heard of your God and heard of how mighty he is. And I want to save your lives. I want to hide you. I want to hide you so that I can do this for you because I trust in your God. And they said because she trusted in God, they told her, when this walls fall and this city falls, you hang a scarlet cord out your window. And they will pass you by, and you and your household will not die. And so she hung that scarlet cord, and sure enough, the walls came down, and everyone had died. And guess who was still standing? Rahab and her family behind the scarlet cord. Spoiler alert, by the way, do you know who the scarlet cord represented? The blood of Jesus Christ. Isn't that amazing? A lot of people think we don't see Jesus Christ till the New Testament. We see him all over. Jesus is in the Old Testament, the New Testament, his blood, and the message of Christianity is woven all through the Old Testament and the New Testament. But Rahab, by faith, she trusted and she was delivered. Look at verse 32. What more shall I say? For time will fail me to talk about Gideon and Barak and Samson and Jephthah and also of David and Samuel and the prophets. Ever met someone and they told you so many stories, you thought, when in the world are they ever going to stop telling me stories? Some of you met my dad before, I know. Just teasing. There's some others in here that tells a lot of stories too. But anyways, I'm not going to point any names, but he says, listen, I could tell you on and on and on and on, story after story after story. I could tell you so many of them that the time would fail me. But here's a few more. Gideon, what a story of Gideon. Gideon, by faith, took down these armies, and he was nothing but a milquetoast of a man who didn't have a backbone, but yet God used him to do a mighty thing through him, and God used him to win a great battle. Barak, not Obama, by the way, all right? This is before his time. He, with Deborah, won this battle that was impossible, but God made it possible. Everyone said there's no way you could win, but with God, it was possible. Samson, you know the story of Samson, the strongest man in the Bible. He defeated many enemies of God, and he battled the Philistines. He battled all of them, and he had some great victories, and God gave him his great strength, and he did great and mighty things for God. Jephthah, he was a judge that defeated the army of the Ammonites. David, of course, we know the story of David. He, by faith, slung the stone, and God slayed the giant. That's exactly how it worked. It wasn't the stone that slayed Goliath. It was God who slayed Goliath. And David had faith, and what a story of great faith. Samuel, the prophet, and many, we could go on and on and on. And the writer does describe some of their victories in verse 33 through 35. He says they subdued kingdoms. They worked righteousness. They obtained promises. They stopped the mouths of lions. They quenched the violence of fire. They escaped the edge of the sword. Out of weakness, they were made strong. They became valiant in battle. They turned to flight of the armies of the aliens. Women received their dead, raised to life again. Others were tortured, not accepting deliverance. They may obtain a better resurrection. What's the point of all these things? Through faith, we trust in a God who can do some mighty things. We trust in a God who can do the impossible. Listen, when we trust in God, we're asking the God of the universe to get involved in our life. And by faith, we can trust in him, and God can do the impossible in our lives. He can do things we could never even imagine. And many times in our life, God does mighty and wonderful things, and he gives the victory. And through him and his power, we praise his name, and he delivers. We serve a God who can do mighty things when we walk by faith. The Old Testament's full of it. The New Testament's full of it. Our lives today are full of it. How many of you this morning can stand up and give a testimony of a testifying of God has done some mighty things in your life that only he could do? I tell you, if you're saved and you know Jesus Christ, that's one you can praise God for because you were dead in your trespasses and sins. And only God could raise you to life again. Only the Spirit of God can bring new life into your heart. Only He could do that. And God has changed hearts. God has changed hard hearts. And God has changed marriages. God has changed financial situations. God has provided miraculous ways. And God has healed diseases. God has touched people's souls and lives. And God has done mighty things. And He can do mighty things. And we, by faith, trust in a God who can. We serve a mighty God. Throughout the Old Testament, He parts the Red Sea, and He slays giants, and He crumbles nations, and He does the impossible. That's when we look to God. We got to look by faith to know He's not a weak God. He's not a God who is not able. He is able. And if you got an impossible situation, God is the right one to call upon, all right? He is, because He is mighty. And in my life, I have certainly seen His power. He has done things in my life that people would look and say, that's unexplainable other than God. That's who can do it in your life, in my life. In this church, God has done unexplainable things. Not because of who I am or because of who you are, only because of who God is. He has done things with people's lives and testimonies and hearts and marriages that only God could do. And in our trust and faith in God, we should never question the power of God. He can deliver. Has He ever delivered you? Has there ever been a time in your life when you called on His name and you knew only He could do something in that situation and God has done it? God did the impossible. That's what faith is. Faith is trusting in God to do the impossible. And this faith that we read about in the Old Testament, the New Testament, we know He is able. You're here this morning, you got something in your life, and you know that there's nothing that can help you or no one who could do something about it. I got good news for you. You can call on God. He can do something about it. That's the God we serve. And this morning, when you think about faith, think about a God who can. But that's not all there is to faith. Faith is not just seeing God or knowing God can do the impossible. Faith is trusting God and knowing that He can, but trusting in Him even if He doesn't. You might say, all right, Pastor Ted, you lost me there, all right? By faith, I thought I should get God to do anything I want. After all, Jesus said, whatever I ask in His name, it will be given unto me, right? Listen, what it actually says is whatever is according to God's will be given unto you, all right? Faith never supersedes God's will. Faith never thwarts the purposes of God. And the truth is, sometimes God can deliver because He always can, but He chooses not to deliver. And what is your faith, or how is your faith when God chooses not to deliver? I know this is hard, and I know it's difficult to hear, but it's biblical. It's biblical. It doesn't make sense sometimes in our life. And the question is, does God become less in our life because He chooses not to deliver us? Does that mean we should have less faith in Him when He chooses not to do it, even though we know He is able? Does that mean only those who have great faith, God delivers, and those who have less faith, God doesn't deliver as well? He lets them suffer? No. The truth is, sometimes God's will is not to deliver. Sometimes it's God's will to allow things in our life. And look what it says in verses 36 through 39. We love to quote the other verses, but look at these verses. Still others had trials of mockings and scourgings, yes, of chains and imprisonment. They were stoned, they were sawn in two, they were tempted, they were slain with the sword, they wandered in sheepskins and goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, tormented of those whom the world was not worthy. They wandered in deserts and mountains and dens and caves of the earth. Some were beaten with rods. Think about that. They were literally beaten for their faith and trust in God. They trusted God to the very end, and they are still beaten. Some were mocked. Some were openly mocked. Some were in prison. Some were in chains. Paul, the apostle, he was put in prison as well. Some were stoned. Not the good way, by the way, all right? I was watching the movie last night, The Jesus Revolution, and through the 60s and 70s, and most maybe you've seen the movie or not, but it's through the whole Jesus Revolution. And we had to keep explaining to Courtney and them what stoned were, how they were looking so happy, right? They were so happy because of the things they were taking and the drugs they were doing. They were stoned. That's basically what I told them. They were stoned, but not like, that's not this kind of stoned, all right? This kind of stone was bad, all right? They were killed. They were hit with stones and rocks and put to death. Sawn in two, that's an interesting one. Historians say this is the prophet Isaiah. The king was so upset because he saw the glory of God that he literally had him sawn in two. That they literally, as he was alive, sawed him in two. You don't think Isaiah was calling on God to deliver him? You don't think his family was? You don't think those around him had faith and trust that God could keep that from happening? Some were poor, some were tormented. Some wandered, nothing of this world. They slept in dens and caves. And listen, you're not going to hear this in your Best Life Now books, all right? You're not going to you're not hear this in the Western Christianity. I guarantee you, you go home and Google the top 10 sermons for this week, you won't hear this in those sermons. You won't hear this because what we believe in Western Christianity is that God will do anything for you if you just believe. You just trust He will heal, He will do all these things, and you can command it. And I know this isn't popular, but it's true, it's biblical. Let me tell you, it's going to help you with your walk with God. It was true in the Old Testament, it's true in the New Testament, it's true today. We look at Jesus. Jesus was a great example for us. He was the Son of God. He was sinless. If anyone didn't deserve to be punished or anyone who didn't deserve to have anything done to him, it was Jesus. And yet, He was beaten. He had no home. He was tempted. He was betrayed. He was given over. He was crucified. Paul was stoned. He was beaten. He was afflicted. Peter was martyred. As a matter of fact, historians say he was hung upside down and crucified. The Apostle John was exiled. John the Baptist was beheaded. Listen, even today, great Christians who believe in God and trust in the Lord, they get cancer. People who love God and they have kids who pass away, they have kids who have troubles, they have kids who have trials. I talk to them every day. I get to counsel with people. I get to talk to them even in my own life. I have my kids. They struggle, and I pray, God, do this for them. You can do it, God, but when He chooses not to, does that make my faith any more or any less? Some Christians are poor. Some Christians suffer. Some are mocked. Does that mean we should have less faith in God? Is that what it means to have faith in God is only when He delivers? No. What the writer of Hebrews is telling us is that whether He delivers or He doesn't deliver, faith is walking in God and leaving the results to Him. It's to know, and I know this is hard, and I know this is hard because it does it in my life as well. And when God is doing great and mighty things, it's praise the Lord. I'm singing, you know, I'm so blessed by Cain. I'm singing all the great songs, right? And yet when I'm going to the hospital, I'm hearing of dangers and toils, things are not going all that well, I begin to doubt. And we're just programmed to begin to think, well, there can't be something wrong with God. There's got to be something wrong with me. It's because of my faith. It's because I'm not strong enough in my faith. And all of a sudden, because good things aren't happening in our humanity, we think, well, my kids are struggling, my health is struggling, my family is hurting, and yet there's got to be something wrong with my faith. Sometimes there's nothing wrong with your faith. It's God's will for your life. And how you respond makes all the difference in the world. Are you going to trust in God when bad things happen? Are you going to trust in God when all these things happen? Because the truth of the matter is it doesn't matter about the results. It matters about your heart. It matters about who you believe in and why you believe in Him. And look at what it says in verse 39. And all these, this is the verse we read. All these, having obtained a good testimony through faith, did not receive the promise. You see that? All these, the good and the bad. Those who were sawn in two and those who were delivered. Those who stopped the mouth of lions and those who were eaten by the lions. Those who were delivered from prison and those who continued to be incarcerated because of the work of God. And no matter what God can deliver, and if God chooses to let you suffer, all these were by faith. You still got to trust in God. You still got to get up and take another step of faith. And that is what obtains a good testimony through the Lord. Your kids got to see you struggle. And when you struggle, you got to show them you still trust in God. It's the way of life. It's the way through Christianity. God is mighty and He can deliver and we walk by faith, but He also lets us suffer and we have pain and we still got to walk by faith. The exhortation is here. It's faith is not just happens when He does mighty things. It's even when He chooses not to do the mighty things. Think about your faith. Do you only trust God when He does mighty things in your life? That's what I keep repeating. That's why I keep repeating from chapter 11. And also, I mentioned last week, Charles Stanley passing away. Charles Stanley passed away, and he walked with God. And one of his favorite quotes was, "Trust in God and leave all the consequences to Him." That's what he would tell his kids. And that's what he lived by. And similar to that, faith is trusting in God and leaving all the results to him. That means I'm trusting God. He can, and even if he doesn't, I'm still going to believe in him because my faith in God is not determined by the results in God. If he delivers, praise God. If he chooses not to deliver, praise God. I still have faith. I still trust in him. You know, there's certain messages in your life with your walk with the Lord, it just changes you. You'll never forget. For me, when I was first starting going to church, I was going to First Baptist Church in Jacksonville. And I had a pastor. He was pretty good, Dr. Jerry Vines. I don't know if you ever heard of him or not. That's a joke, by the way. He was a great pastor. Great preacher. Matter of fact, when I started seminary, I didn't know how great of a preacher he was. The first book they give you about preaching was written by Dr. Jerry Vines. So I was like, okay. He definitely was a great, great preacher. And he preached a message about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And the title of his message, it was a Sunday night church. And the title of his message was this. He says, "Does your faith have an if not clause?" I thought, that's an interesting statement, right? And just before we even hear the story, I tell you about his sermon, it's a great question for you to ask yourself or for me to ask myself. Does your faith have an if not clause? And here's what he said. He took us to the story of Daniel and his buddies. Daniel and his buddies were taken into captivity. If you remember, they had wandered away from God, and God says, okay, you want to go your own way? Then you can be led into captivity. Sure enough, they were led into captivity by the Babylonians, and they were trying to reprogram them. And they chose the select ones. They chose the best ones they could find, and they were bringing them in to indoctrinate them, to change them, to send them back out into their people, to change their people. To reprogram them. And so what they were teaching them was, what you used to believe, you don't believe anymore. Now you believe in the government, now you believe in the king, and now you believe the things of the world. You know what the first thing they did? Took them away from their parents. I don't know about you, but there should be some red flags that go up when people want to take kids away from their parents, right? They took them away from their parents, took them away from their family. Then they changed their names and their identity. They were called by a Hebrew name. Now they were going to call them by a Babylonian name. Then they not only changed their identity, they began to indoctrinate them. They began to put their thoughts in them. They began to give them worldly pleasures. And they began to say, all right, since you've gone this far now, you must bow down to our gods. And they began to do this to him. And yet we know the story of Daniel. Immediately Daniel took a stand and he said, I'm not going to take any of the things of this world. You can go ahead and take those, and I'm not going to do it. And he challenged him. We know the story at the end of that. Daniel gets thrown in the lion's den, and sure enough, God delivered Daniel from the lion's den, and we all know that story. But he had the three buddies, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Those were his Babylonian names. And what happened to them was they continued to serve. They got put into these higher places because they had an excellent spirit in them, and God was providing a way for them. And yet they get up to the top of the things. And in Daniel chapter 3, it gives us a story of their encounter with this King Nebuchadnezzar. And in verse 8 through 25 is the story. If you want to write that down, you could go back and look at it later. But I'm going to read through some of this story and give you the context. And I want to show you the principle out of this. So there was a certain name, people who come from the Chaldeans, and they came forward and they accused these three Hebrew children. They went to the King Nebuchadnezzar and they said, oh, King, live forever. You are the greatest king of all time. And basically, they were kissing up to the king, right? They were telling him, oh, you are wonderful and you are great and you are mighty. And he says, oh, King, you've made this decree that at the sound of this horn and flute and harp and lyre and psaltery, and when the music starts, everyone in the presence of that music must fall down and worship your God and worship you. And whoever does not, they got to be thrown in the fiery furnace. And so he says, yes, I made that. The king was talking and they were going back. Yes, I've made that decree. And anyone who does not do that will be put into the fiery furnace. And they said, oh, good, because we know three Hebrew children, right? A tattletale. Nobody likes a tattletale, right? They went back, oh, King, you're wonderful. And they were kissing up. Now they're saying, oh, yes, now that you've said that, we have these three Hebrews or three Jewish people, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Every time the song is played, they do not bow down and worship. They do not fall down and worship the image that we have. So Nebuchadnezzar, in a rage and a fury, he commanded them to go get Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He says, bring them to me. And Nebuchadnezzar looked at him and said, is this true? Is this true that you won't bow down? And they didn't say nothing to him. He says, now I'm going to give you one more chance. And when I play this music and I you hear this harp and the lyre and the psaltery in my presence, if you bow down and worship then, he says, I will deliver you. And he says, if you don't bow down, I have a question for you. What God is going to deliver you from my wrath? In other words, I'm the king and I'm supreme and there's no one who can deliver you from my hands. And so Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and they said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. You know when people get angry at you and you don't give them an answer, that really makes it even matter, right? It's like, we don't even have to answer you. Because if that is the case, meaning that they'll have to bow down, our God, whom we serve, is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us from your hand, O king. There we go. They had faith that God could do the impossible. They were in an impossible situation. They knew God was possible. He could make it possible. They could be delivered. That in a moment, God could deliver them from that fiery furnace. What great faith that is, right? They had the faith to say, we're in a situation we cannot solve ourselves, and we're trusting in God to do something we know we can't do of ourselves, because we cannot overcome the king, we cannot overcome his armies, and we certainly can't overcome the fiery furnace, but we know a God who can do that. That's faith. But then verse 18 comes, and they wasn't finished yet. But if not, let it be known to you, O king, that we will never serve your gods and will never worship the God of the image that you have set up. Isn't that amazing? They said, God, you are able, but even if he don't, he is still God. That's the if not clause. And the rest of the story is Nebuchadnezzar, he gets so mad at them and he gets exceedingly angry at them. He commands them to fire up the furnace 7 times hotter. He was so enraged. So the men who bound up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they went to cast them in the fiery furnace. Even those who cast them into the fire, they were burned as they cast them into the fire. And there they were in their trousers, their coats, the turbans, and everything else they had on them. And the king's command was urgent. And like I said, he threw them into the fire. And Nebuchadnezzar, astonishedly, he rose in haste and he looked to his counselors. He said, did we not cast 3 men into the midst of the fiery furnace? And they said, oh, true, it's true, O king. And he said, look, I see 4 men loose walking in the midst of the fire and they are not hurt. And the 4th man is like the Son of God. Isn't that amazing? I mean, what a story. And if you think about this kind of faith, that even in the midst of them wanting God to deliver them from the fiery furnace, they had the if not clause in their faith. And the question for you is, do you have that kind of faith? You have that kind of faith that God is able to quench the fire, and if he doesn't quench the fire, you know and trust that he will walk you through it no matter what. You know, we started with Psalm 23. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, right? We know that God is with us. Do you really believe that? That's what trusting God is. That's what faith is. Faith is trusting God and leaving all the results to him. It is knowing God can deliver, and if he chooses not to, he's still a mighty God. He is still God. He is still worthy to be pursued. And even in the midst of the lowest of the low and the hottest fiery furnace we could ever walk through, he will be there with us. He will never leave us and he will never forsake us. That is what biblical faith is. Biblical faith is leaving the results to him and knowing that my God can deliver, and even if he doesn't, I still choose to trust in him. Shortly after I got sick a couple years ago, some of you know I couldn't preach for a couple months. And there were a lot of things happening in our life. My brother was going through a terrible time, and he was on a ventilator and a life support. My family was sick. There was a lot of people in our church that was sick. Some people were that I knew had passed away. And I thought, God, what are you doing in my life? God, I just know in my heart, my life, I was always the type of person I knew. God, I've always been strong. I've always been able to get up and go to work. I've always been able to do these things. And God, what in the world has happened? Like, now I can't do anything. I can't even walk from my bed to the living room. I can't even get out of the hospital bed for 10 days, laying flat on my back. God, what are you doing in my life? And through that process, you know, after I got done with that, through those couple months that I couldn't even preach or teach or do anything, when I came back, I preached a sermon series on Jonah. You remember that? And Jonah, in Jonah, what the biggest lesson from Jonah was that you got to surrender everything you have to God. Everything. And when you trust in God, you are saying, I'm putting everything I have in who God is. And no matter what happens, they're all in, all my eggs are in His basket. I'm fully trusting in Him. And you know what? It really comes down to one single word. You know what that word is? Surrender. You know why so many of us don't see God do great things in our life? We don't walk by faith. It's because we want to control our own lives. We want to manipulate what God does in our lives. But let me tell you, God will not be manipulated. Your faith cannot manipulate God's will for you, and God's will be done. And the question is, by faith, are you going to trust Him when He does great and mighty things? And are you going to trust Him when He doesn't do great and mighty things? These believers here at Hebrews, they were struggling. We know the context of this. They were new Christians. There were those who were falling away in the faith. There were those who were turning back, and they were tempted, and they were being tested. And they were on the verge of throwing in a towel and giving it up and saying, we don't want to walk with God anymore. And the writer of Hebrews writes this letter to encourage them, to exhort them, to further let them understand what faith in God is. And the whole purpose of chapter 11 and the whole purpose of the book of Hebrews is wherever you are in your walk with God, take one more step. Take one more step. It's worth fighting for. It's worth to take the next step of faith by God and trusting in Him, even when you don't see Him working. Even when you don't see the results that you want, surrender your heart completely to Him. And the question for you and for me is, am I trusting God and leaving all the results to Him? There are some here this morning in your marriage, you want to try to control that. And you think you can change your spouse. You know who can change your spouse? Only God can. That's it. You know, when I first got married, 23 years ago, if you can believe that, 23 years ago, I had a list of things that I wanted to change about Erin. I thought, man, if I could just change these things about her, I'd just make her such a great, better person. You know what I mean? Like, our marriage would be great. And man, I battled, tried to change those things. And through that process, you know what I needed? You know what I learned? She didn't need to change. I needed to change, all right? And God began to work on my life. And then I began to surrender those things to God and say, you know what, God? Only You can change a person, because when you battle one another, you're trying to change someone that only God could change. Listen, in your marriage, not just in your marriage, but even in your life, in your career, in your walk with God, even in a sickness or even in cancer, you know who could only one who could change your situation? Only God. And for you and for me, we must put all we have in trusting in God that He is able and He can do it. And even when He chooses not to, we got to walk with Him and take one more step of faith. One more step. Trust God and leave all the results to Him, everything you have, surrendered to Jesus Christ and walking by faith. And God will do mighty and great things. God can move mountains. God can part Red Seas. And you'll see a lot of those things. But sometimes He will choose not to, and you'll walk through health crisis. You'll walk through marriage problems. You'll walk through kid problems. You'll walk through financial issues. But I can promise you this, every step of the way, Jesus will be right there with you. He'll never leave you, and He'll never forsake you. Do you trust in God and leave all the results to Him? That's the end of chapter 11. Let's pray together. Dear Father, we do come before You, Lord. God, I do pray, even this morning, Lord, in this room, there are those that are facing the impossible. They've gotten to the end of themselves. God, maybe as someone who is trusting in themselves to save themselves, Lord, maybe they felt like, you know what, if I do enough good things, or I go to church enough, or I'm a good person, I can earn the salvation of God. Man, I pray this morning, God, that they come to the end of that and realize that I'm completely surrendering to the Lord. That it is only God and God alone who can save me. And this morning, I just invite you to call out by faith and say, Jesus, save me. That's it. I believe on You, Jesus Christ. And the Bible says when we take that step of faith, that saving faith, that He will regenerate our hearts. Literally, we become born again from the Spirit of God. And this morning, you don't have to try harder or join a church or walk this aisle. You just got to believe on the name of Jesus Christ. And this morning, you can do that right where you sit. You can say, Lord, I've made a mess of my life. I'm trusting in you, God. I'm trusting in you and who you are and how you have provided salvation for my soul. And this morning, you can call in the name of Jesus. Or maybe you're here this morning, you are struggling. You're in that fiery furnace. And you're asking God, do you really exist? Are you really going to come through with me? God, what in the world is going on in my life? In the midst of that furnace or in the midst of a greatest victory of your life, you got to surrender to God. You got to say, God, here's my heart, 100%. I'm giving it all to you and I'm leaving all the results to you. And God, I pray, even before we get to that furnace, even before we get to the storms of our life, that God, we will surrender our hearts to you. And we will say, God, it's not what I want, but what you want, God. And I'm fully trusting in your plan for my life and your will for my life. And God, I know you're able, but when you choose not to, I'm still going to follow you, God. And I know that you're going to be with me every step of the way. Listen, there is testimony after testimony of what God has done through brokenness, through despair, through failure, and how God has made it better than ever before. He can do that. He can take our biggest defeats in life and turn them into our greatest victories. You know how that happens? By faith. By trusting in God through the dark times and through the good times. And to know that he is in control. And this morning, maybe you're here and you say, I don't even know if God knows I exist. He does. He knows you. He has a plan for your life. And if you trust in him, he can do things you could never imagine in your life. And even when things fall apart, he will be there. And he never leaves you and he never forsakes you. And God, I just pray this morning as we begin to consider our hearts, as we have this time of invitation, we're going to play a song. As we play this song, I just encourage you right where you sit, if you'll lift your heart up to the Lord and say, here's my heart, Lord, fully surrendered to your will this morning. And I pray that every single person that walks out of this room will be able to say, I'm trusting in God and I'm going to leave all the results to him no matter what. I pray that be our prayer. Listen, we've got a few minutes. I just ask you to keep your heads bowed and your eyes closed and seek the Lord this morning. Say, God, do a work in my heart that'll never